Good afternoon, and thank you for coming to our talk about clustering actor model. My name is Vagif. I'm consultant working for Norwegian company Miles, working last few years for project for NRK, Norwegian Broadcasting Corporation. And together with me on stage is Pawel.
Hi, I'm Pawel. I work for Making Waves. I live in Poland, in Kraków. And I've been involved in this project with Vagif for around 1.5 years.
We have put several question words in the title of our talk. And we try to build the presentation around these questions. And of course, we will try to present our answers as we understand, as we see them. A couple of years ago, when we already had system in production, but it was non-clustered system. We also talked about it in several events, including NDC. And after one of the presentation, I got a question from the audience. A guy asked why I didn't cover clustering scenario. And I said, because we didn't support clustering scenario. We didn't support cluster, but we had system in production. And he wasn't really convinced with my answer. He said that you have an important mission critical system. It must work in the cluster. So that actually gives us first question, why? There is a so-called first law of distributed objects formulated by Martin Fowler, which states don't distribute your objects. Of course, actor model is not about objects. And over time, we have built our motives, our reasons to distribute our actor system or actor systems. So this is a story we're going to share with you. And it's a part of a bigger and older story, which is a story of Norwegian Broadcasting Corporation. It's like analog of BBC, but just in Norway. And its story started almost a century ago. It was first radio, of course, and TV. And now, today, it's about like a million programs that made its way to the cloud, to different CDN providers. So in brief, and this is this slide from our earlier presentation, about non-clustered version of our system, we working with so-called distributed engine. And this is a service or set of services that distributes media files, radio programs. They consist of multiple files for different rendering qualities. And it's all distributed to the cloud. I mean, it supports throttling and other things. So this is our product. And in the eyes and in the ears of our viewers and listeners, it looks like this. They can render it on mobile and desktop devices on demand. So when Pawel joined us, that was approximately internal system design.
Yeah, so how I'm you find going it? To quickly go through this model here that I have. That shows the internal architecture of our system. So it all starts with this set of durable queues, which are implemented using RabbitMQ. And this is the entrance to our system. And this is the communication layer between us and all the other teams inside NRK that want to push our system to do an actual work. So here we get the information that there is some new TV program, radio, podcast, whatever, subtitles, changes that needs to be delivered to the client. So we read those commands that we not always have control over from those queues, and we fetch them into a set of Windows services. Each of them implements a system built on top of Akka.net, obviously. And those services, they serve the role of some anti-corruption layer. They are stateless. They just translate those commands that are in the queues into our internal representation. They do some validation, stuff like that. And all of that goes into another set of durable queues from which we fetch these jobs, how we call them, into a single service, or I should say that it used to be a single service. That was the core of our system. And this single service, it contained multiple tricky parts like persistence layer. It's displayed here as this event journal. So here we had a connection to our database where we stored information about the progress of uploading all those programs. And here we also had a transport layer. And it is shown here on the slide because this is the actual part that does the throttling. Because it turns out that the CDN providers to which we upload the files, we cannot throw at them programs as fast as we are able. They give us some constraints. So for example, we can upload to a single folder no more than 10 programs in parallel. So here it is implemented. We implement this throttling also in the single service. It was a single service because it needed to touch the database, and that's why we had to implement it in that way. And of course, there is the CDN, or maybe I should say multiple CDNs, because we distribute it among all like different cloud providers. So that is a brief state of what we had before we went clustering. And around the time that Akka.net guys, they released the ready-to-production versions of Akka clustering libraries, we started looking at them, and we started asking ourselves the questions, if that is something that we actually want to use, if our system actually requires having those cluster abstractions.
Yeah, so that's give us first question, why? Because we already had working system in production. And, So actors offer a lot of simplicity when it comes to message handling. And it felt a little bit like we're throwing out of the window some of the advantages of this simple message handling. In particular, ordered message delivery. You have multiple nodes. How will you achieve that? Guaranteed message delivery. What if nodes lose each other? It's a different story than if you have just one machine, especially one service. And not to say about uniqueness of an actor path, because when you have a cluster, you're actually running multiple actor systems. And within actor system, you can only create one, like a file. You can only have one actor with a given path. How will it work when we have multiple nodes, multiple systems talking to each other? And of course, on top of it is a CAP theorem, which states that of those three letters, consistency, availability, and partition tolerance, you can have only two. And since all systems must tolerate partitioning, like network partition, this is something that happens, that it gives us only two letters to choose from. And one choice is to sacrifice availability. That's quite a boring choice, as you see from this boring screen. And another is it can have actually more catastrophic consequences if you sacrifice consistency of your system. So, why?
Yeah, we started asking ourselves this question, and then we started digging into the documentation and all the knowledge that is available on the internet, and then we found several reasons that you could choose from when you try to decide that you actually want to implement the clusterized system. So first reason that might convince you is the need to scale out your problem. That means that if your problem is very CPU intensive or something like that, then you can buy more and more expensive hardware. But at some point, you will realize that it is actually cheaper to distribute your problem and run it on several cheaper machines, and you are going to get what you want out of your system faster and cheaper that way. And that wasn't necessarily the case for our problem, because as I mentioned, we are mostly constrained by our agreements with the CDN providers when we upload them those files. So we needed to look further. And we found out that there is also this thing about the system being available all the time. When we have a single machine running the core service of our system, then that machine sometimes needs to be restarted. For example, when there is a need to install updates and stuff like that. And then our system is simply offline, or used to be offline, I should say. When you start distributing your system on multiple machines, then you can have parts of your system still delivering, still working on processing those messages while the other machines restarted. So this gives us the possibility to have higher availability. But on top of that, there are some other advantages of splitting your system into multiple submodules that you run side by side. For example, you can do much more interesting stuff with rolling out new features of your application. You can run, for example, two different versions of a module side by side and route some of the traffic to both of them and see how they behave and how they handle the load after you did some changes to the logic of the application. And you can also move those applications at different pace to different environments. So this gives you a lot of possibility to catch bugs earlier. And also, the last reason, it seems a little bit strange at first, but...
explanation, this statement.
Yeah. We started working on our system. We created it using actor model. And actor model is designed to be distributed among multiple machines in cluster. And I'm going to explain why I think that is the case. When you have actors, they communicate with each other asynchronously just by passing each other messages. And they don't care whether the recipient actor, whether it lives in the same process or in the same machine or some totally other machine. It's referentially transparent. So I think that in this model, this is already built in, this notion of not really caring about where all the actors live. And that makes it really easy to go from a non-clustered version of your system to a clustered version compared to a situation where if we did implement that in a regular object-oriented way.
Yeah. So we don't contradict with Martin Fowler because we don't distribute objects.
Yeah, I think that you can say that, because with objects, then you would need to have objects call each other's methods and affect their state, and then you would need to have some remote procedure calls and all that stuff.
Exactly.
That's not the case with actors. So given all that, we decided that we are actually going to experiment and try out this clustering thing and see how it works.
Yeah, when the short answer to this question is as late as possible, because you have enough challenges to implement your domain properly. And of course, you will fail to implement your domain properly from the first attempt. So get it right, or as right as you can. You don't. The least what you expect at that time is to start configuring failing nodes of the cluster. So make it work. So remember this diagram which Pawel started with. So which we have chosen the least complicated part of it. And this is command adapter. We're receiving commands from various adapters, from news clips, from TV, radio. And this is a stateless. Just one DTO is transferred to another DTO. So this is actually a very good experience to try to cluster it. And we have received a portion of surprises. So it was actually very good that we started at this simple part. Then next, we expanded to more complicated areas, and like transport protocol. It's also stateless, but now we're talking to external services, and we're also throttling our message. So that, how will it work if you need to throttle and you have to have given number of connectors per the whole cluster? That's a different scenario. It's called clustered routers. We're going to look at them. And finally, the trickiest part, of course, something which touches your persistent layer. And this is persistent actors. This is something which writes and reads from event journal. So that was we saved until the last, like a dessert. And we don't regret that, because this is the most tricky part and actually required to do some design changes.
Yeah, and if you do this wrong, you corrupt your database, and you don't want to deal with that afterwards.
Yeah, exactly. So and then we planning work on rough edges, because if you see, there is another durable queue. It looks like a transaction guard in a way. But it's actually we're sending from one part of the system to another part of the system. And now that we have gained our experience with clustering actor model, we consider to unite all these nodes into this like single system. So we only have durable queue at the entrance of the system. So that brings us to the question that requires longest answer. How? So this is what we're going to demonstrate now. We built some demos, and we need some definitions before.
Yeah, so I'm going to show you some demos, and I'm going to explain them. But before I dive into that, I want to explain some terms that I'm going to throw around so that we have a mutual understanding of what I'm even talking about. So the first thing is a node. So what is a node? A node is a logical unit inside the cluster. And a node is identified by three things. It's a hostname, port, and some unique ID that is relevant to, like, when you spawn this actor system, that it gets this unique ID.
So node is not a machine. That's very important.
That's very important. Node is not a machine. You can run multiple nodes on the same machine, or even in the same process. You can think of a node as like a single actor system that is going to talk to other nodes. So that brings us to the cluster, which is simply a collection of nodes with that detail that these nodes need to know about each other and needs to communicate with each other. Because if you just have a bunch of nodes that they don't know about each other's existence, then it doesn't form any sort of cluster. Then you have a role. And a role is it defines a purpose of this particular node. So it's a feature of a node. So to give you an example, you can have a cluster that consists of multiple nodes, and some of the nodes are dealing with the backend stuff, so they have a role of backend, and some of the nodes are dealing with the frontend stuff, and they have the role of frontend. And you are going to use the role in order to spawn different types of actors on each of them.
Can you combine the roles in one?
One node can also have serve multiple roles at the same time, and this role is something that you statically define in your config for each of these nodes. And then you have a leader. A leader is somewhat similar to role, but this is not something that you statically define, that this node is going to be always the leader. It's just the leader gets selected out of all the nodes. And the leader is responsible for moving nodes into the cluster and kicking nodes out of the cluster when they decide to leave. So that is its responsibility. And it doesn't get elected with the meaning of something like a democratic process. It's just one of them that is on top of the set of all the nodes that each node see. So given all that, I'm going to go and show you some of those stuff. But first, I need to warn you that the examples are going to be in F#.
Who understands F#?
Yeah, an experience here?
Yeah.
Quite a lot, actually.
Those who didn't raise hands, you will understand, of course.
Yeah, so I'm using F#, I'm using Akklink here, and we are using F# for two reasons. One is that we actually built our system in F#, so it felt like a natural choice, and second is that it's going to fit into the screen much easier. But just to give a brief comparison of what you are going to read, on top I have the way how you create an actor in C#. So we create a class, and you override some methods, and I'll call these methods in constructor, stuff like that. In F#, one of the ways to, and the one that I'm going to use, is to just create a function, and this function gets some mailbox context handling thing that doesn't that important, and it gets a message. So this function is going to process this message, and in the body, this is going to what is actually going to happen when the message is received.
So just less lines, basically.
Yeah. And then it's another set. On top of that, it's creating new actors. So we can see that this is basically the same words, but just shuffled and put into different order. And on the bottom is sending a message to an actor. So in C# we have this tell method, and in F# we have this fancy operator. So whenever you see this weird left arrow, that means that we are sending a message to the actor. Simple as that.
So we just be using mostly these two types of commands, so it's very simple.
Yeah, so given all that, you should follow that without problems. So let me just quickly go to the demos. Yep. Is that big enough for everyone? I can't hear now. So.
Yeah.
Okay, so in the first demo, I'm going to show you how to create the simplest possible cluster. And I'm going to use something called F# Interactive that most of you already know about.
And Visual Studio Code.
Yeah, this is like a REPL kind of environment. So here is the most important thing. It's going to define the configuration of our cluster, because it turns out that most of the clustering thing, that most of the things that you need to change in order to have your Akka system clusterized is related to configuration, really. So you need to change provider to be a cluster. You need to specify remoting, because Akka clustering library is built on top of Akka remoting. So I mentioned that you need to have a node needs to have a hostname and port, so this is where you actually define it. And then you have a new cluster node where you specify the role that I mentioned before, and then you specify also the seed nodes. So what are the seed nodes? Seed nodes are useful when a new node tries to join an existing cluster. It needs to know where the cluster actually lives. It needs to know to which system or which address it's going to be something that it's going to communicate with in order to join the cluster. So this thing is a seed node. And there are many ways to to implement this thing of cluster discovery, discovery nodes inside the cluster, but this is the simplest one. So it specifies statically say that one node is going to have this host and port, and this one is going to welcome all the nodes.
By the way, the same configuration will work on JVM in Scala, so it's platform agnostic.
Yeah, exactly. So then we have we start our first system. And we can see in logs down here that the leader is moving the node up. So at that point, we have a functioning cluster system in Akka that consists only of a single node. So that's not that interesting. So let's just create another system. And then we see the message that the leader is moving the second node under the different port, 5001, to up. And now we have two nodes running side by side that formed a cluster. And it looks like it's nothing is happening. Because we didn't create any actors, we didn't do anything that could perform any work here. But that's not actually true that nothing is happening. So I'm going to show you that by just turning on the debug logging here. And I'm quickly going to run this thing again. Okay. So we are starting the first system. There is some more output here, and I'm starting the second system. And this is the thing that I wanted to show you. Gossip status. So what we see here is that the nodes are communicating with each other constantly using something called gossip protocol. And this gossip serves two purposes. First of all, it's a failure detection mechanism. So the nodes know about each other, and as long as they gossip with each other, they know that nothing wrong happened with them. But when the nodes they stop responding to each other's heartbeats, then the nodes know that something is going wrong, and maybe there should be some reaction to that. And the second thing that the gossip protocol handles is the spreading of the information about the shape of the cluster and about all the existing nodes that are already in the cluster. Because when a new node joins a cluster, it doesn't know anything about any nodes that form the cluster already. But it might want to send messages to them. So how does it actually get the information about all the other nodes? Well, via the gossip protocol. So this is like this mechanism that serves those purposes.
So don't run Akka cluster on a mobile subscription where you pay per megabyte.
Yeah, exactly. It's going to be a little chatty.
It's very chatty, yeah.
And there is one more thing that I want to show you. I showed you at first that there are some messages that say leader is moving the node up and down, stuff like that. So we saw the events that let us know that something is happening with the shape of the cluster, but it doesn't show us the state of the cluster. And there is this nice tool that is actually going to allow us to do that. So I just started some peta bridge command line here, and I can use this tool now that gives me a lot of different possible options, among which there are some cluster related. So I can manually do stuff to nodes on my cluster here. And I can, for example, show what is the current shape of my cluster here. So it's going to display all the nodes that consist of the cluster. And this is one of the most useful tools that you need to have whenever you are working with Akka clustering. So that's why I'm showing that to you. OK.
So we just showed now infrastructure, but nothing useful for our domain. Yet.
So I'm going to quickly jump to this slide. Back. Okay, let's go. So let's now talk about some more useful stuff, like what can we actually do once we have this clustering in place. So the first thing, I think that all Akka applications, they have a router somewhere there, which is distributing the load among different processes, different actors. So what you can do in a cluster is you can do the same thing, but you are not distributing load among different actors only, but also among different machines. So I'm going to show that in a demo. So I'm going to just restart this.
So it's basically a demo of our transport, clustered our transport layer that sends files to different CDN providers.
Yeah, I should mention that we have, this is actually modeled after our system. So what we do is we upload files using SFTP commands, and then we send them to some actors, and we have a pool of those actors, and the size of the pool is constrained because of the reasons I mentioned earlier. And we don't care which one is going to upload this particular file. We just want this work to be done. So let's see how is it implemented here. So I'm going to create a config, which is the same as before with one change. I have a deployment node here. And as you can see, I can define routing the same way as I do when I do regular Akka routing without clustering here. This is exactly the same way that you do that. You can define all the different strategies for your routing, like round robin or consistent hashing or whatever you want to use. All of them are available. And then you can also define some cluster-specific things that also define something like how many routes I'm going to spawn or on which role I'm going to create those actors. So now I'm going to create three actor system, and one of them is going to have a role of dispatcher, and this is the one that is going to host the router. And I'm going to spawn two worker systems with the role worker, which are going to hold all the routes. So I just created them. Then I define my domain. This is, to those that don't know F-sharp that well, this is like a simple data type that says that it holds some data. It's either of type upload, and it contains a bunch of strings, or it is of type of delete, and it contains some other bunch of strings. So nothing really fancy here.
And even though it's simplified, it's more or less what we're doing in our system, just uploading files, delete files, which go out of...
Yeah, exactly. And now I define the actor, which is going to be our routine. So what it does, it gets a message, and it looks into this message, and it logs some information about this message. So we are not simulating here an actual work. What we are doing is just logging. Then we create our router on the dispatcher system under the same path as we defined in the config up here, SFTP. And we say to him, like, grab the configuration from the config. But now it's interesting stuff. I can start sending. Did I do something here? Maybe I didn't create the pool. Yeah.
Yeah.
So I have the pool now, and then I can start sending messages to them. And what I'm going to observe is where are those messages actually executed. So here is the actor address, system address on which these messages are executed. And as you can see, they have port 5001 and 5002, which is the worker ports. So it is distributing the load among different nodes. And if I run it on different machines, it will be distributing them on different machines. Simple as that. I just changed the configuration.
Yeah, and use round robin to make it even.
But the more interesting stuff is that if I spawn another worker here, and I sent a bunch more messages to it, then you can see that it started already execute those commands on this new worker. So that says to us that this mechanism is pretty good if you have a problem that scales dynamically, because you can throw, spawn, or create a bunch of new nodes in your cluster, and this is automatically going to start routing these loads to them. And when you remove them, then it is going to obviously just stop throwing more work at them and go back to using the previous ones. And that is all good, but there are some situations where you cannot use this thing. So for example, sometimes you need to send a series of messages that are going to end up at the same actor that is going to process them. And in our case, we have this notion of a program. And then we have multiple files that are associated with this program. For example, they have multiple different qualities, but it is basically the same piece of television. And then we are processing all of that in the same actor. We have some good reasons for that.
So in DDD terminology, it will be aggregate route.
Yeah, in DDD, it would be an aggregate route. So we have like a single actor that is spawning all of these, a single actor per single program.
And if you take analogy from financial area, you have a bank account, and you don't want this bank account payments to be handled in multiple nodes in the system. You won't actually go it sequentially through the same worker for the given account.
Yeah, so that the state gets accumulated sensibly. So what can you do with Akka clustering if you have this situation, which is pretty common, I believe? So what can you do is you use something called sharding. And I'm going quickly through this. Through this diagram here. So the yellow dots are actual actors. So they are these aggregate root domain actors that they have this entity ID. And this entity ID is going to be unique per program, for example, in our case. And these actors, they live inside shards. And these shards live inside the regions. And the important thing is that the shards can move freely between the regions. So when I send a message to a shard region, because this is like the only thing that I can send messages directly to, I don't care on which actual region does my actor live. it's just going to be handled by Akka. So we have these shard regions, you send messages to them, and you need to specify shard ID and entity ID, and it's going to be routed to the correct place. So I think it's going to be simpler when I'm going to just show it to you. So let's restart this thing again. OK, so I'm loading this. I'm creating configuration, and it's going to be the same exact configuration as before.
Except for sharding
except
part.
For, yeah. Except for the sharding part here. And the sharding part, as you can see, it says something about persistence, journal, snapshot store, stuff like that. So it turns out that sharding requires some notion of persistence, because the Akka system, I mean, Akka cluster, it needs to remember where at given point of time the shards live. So if you use persistent actors, then you already have a database to store that information. You can also use something called distributed data, which is going to store it in memory, but distributed among the whole cluster. And so I'm going to start those two actors system, as I usually do, and go quickly through our domain. So this is another plain data type in F#, which is going to just hold those fields. And the program ID is going to be our entity ID in our shards. So then I need to define an actor that is going to process my messages. So this is this actor. And what it does is basically logs the information that the message was received. So it's pretty similar to what I used in this routing demo. But then there is a new thing that I'm going to define. It is a function that gets a message. And based on that message, it needs to define what is the shard ID and entity ID, because this is the pair of the information that is required for it to be for sharding mechanisms to be able to route those messages to the correct actors. So I'm just going to define that, and it uses program ID as entity ID and hash of that as a base to create the shard ID. So now I start two regions. And this is important, because with sharding, you need to start a region on each of your nodes that are going to participate in this mechanism. So now I have two systems, two nodes in my cluster, and two regions, one on each. And then I can start sending the messages finally. So what I'm doing here is I'm creating these two messages that has this, that they have the same program ID. So they should end up being executed on the same actor, but I'm sending them to two different regions. So let's see if it works. And as you can see here, it shows that they got executed on the same system, and the actor path that is executing them is exactly the same. So I verified that they are actually getting routed to the same actor without me even thinking about it. It just happens automatically. And what is more, when I send some other messages with different program ID, they get routed to some other shards. So for example, this one got executed on the system number 2, and the next one is executed on system number 1 because it says port 5000, etc. So what it says to us that the sharding mechanism, it automatically balances the load in your application among your nodes. And this is pretty nice because you don't need to think about it that much. And there is also more to that. When I just decide to remove one of the systems of one of the nodes out of my cluster, which I just did, what happens to all these shards is they get automatically rebalanced to the node that that survived this operation. So when I start sending those messages now, this one was executing on this node before because it's related to program A. But all of the other ones, they are also going to get executed on the same node.
They have no other place to be executed.
Yeah, but what we can see here that the shard ID and the entity ID being part of the actor path, they didn't change from the before examples. So it just shows us that all those shards, they got automatically rebalanced. And they still live in the system, but on the other node. And I didn't need to do anything magical about this.
What if there were messages sending to some actors while system was some node was going down?
Yeah, so this scenario is also covered by Akka, and in a way that these messages get buffered and they get replayed after the rebalancing ends. So, so as long as you have big enough buffer, nothing should really go wrong with that. OK, so I talked about this, and I want to I don't really have time to show you demos about some. OK, so one last thing before I go further. Akka sharding mechanism works pretty well with persisting information in Akka system, because you have so-called persistent actors. And in Akka, nothing really stops you from spawning two of those actors. They are going to have some defined path. But once you run two systems side by side, you can spawn both of them on two systems and run them side by side. And that's how you get corrupted memory or corrupted state of these actors, I should say. And so what you actually need to do when you deal with this persistence, you should put all your persistent actors under your shards, or even make your entity actors, the top-level sharded actors, persistent actors. And then you are going to avoid this situation, because at any given point of time, there is going to be only a single actor with given entity ID and shard ID. So this gives you a way to avoid those problems.
And that's a common practice, just make aggregate root persistent.
Yeah, and this is something that we also needed to change in our system to handle this persistence and where we actually store it, store the information. Okay, so I'm quickly going to talk about two other scenarios that are pretty common in clustered applications. So first thing is like a specialized sharding. So you only have a single actor that you are going to send messages to, but the requirement is that only one instance of this actor can live in a cluster at all times. So in our system, just to give you some concrete example, we use that for moving data from one database to another database in this CQRS type of manner. So this is eventually like it must complete eventually. We don't care if it is that fast. We don't care if it's real time or anything like that. So we can survive the rebalancing of this worker to some other nodes in some situations.
But we care that only it runs in.
Yeah, what
one
we care is
flow.
That we have only one of these actors that are touching the two databases and moving stuff from one to another at any given time. So this is a good fit for that. It's called cluster singleton. And it's pretty similar to regular singleton in the fact that you shouldn't use that really if you have other options. It's going to create maybe a bottleneck in your system if you try to use it too much. So you need to be careful, but this is an option. And another situation is because in all previous demos, when I was sending some messages to actors, I had an actor reference to which I was sending the message to. And there are some situations when I don't really care about having this actor reference, and I just want to shout to the void. And if there are some other actors that are on the listening side, then they are going to process it. If not, then I don't care. So this scenario is covered by something called distributed publish subscribe. So it is similar to an event sub that you have in your regular Akka system, but it works also among the cluster. And you can send those messages on a particular topic, so then multiple receiving actors, then they can subscribe to the topic and listen to that. But you can also use that to send one-to-one type of messages. So you send a message to a particular path, and if there is an actor that lives under this path, it's going to receive that message and listen to that. So you can also have a one-to-one communication implemented using that mechanism. No time for demos. I'm going to just go further, and we go to the topic when something might go wrong.
And of course, something might and will go wrong. And then the question how catastrophic it is when things go wrong and then you suddenly have partitions and they may try to play as just separate clusters. And what is complicated then that we were not sure if it's network that broke.
Yeah, when the heartbeat stops and we stop, like one node stops receiving the heartbeat, it can't really say what happened. Was it like a network breach? Is the machine down? It's like pinging some server and not getting any response. We don't know what's wrong.
Yeah, I guess network have problems more often than machine crashes, but anyway, we don't know. And so is a failure recoverable or permanent? And how should we react without overreacting to that? So actually, it was yesterday, this blog post.
A few days ago, I guess.
There was an excellent explanation about this, that we shouldn't really overreact on it and just too early treat partitions of our cluster as like dead. Okay, it's unreachable. Let's just kill everyone. And then we have just these good nodes that still alive.
Yeah, and we shouldn't do that because Akka provides you with this layer of assurance that nothing is going, like, it's not going to spawn another singletons on some other nodes that are unreachable at any given time, for example. Because what is the problem with having multiple clusters? The problem is when you use sharding or when you use single Akka singleton, you never want to have two of them. So if you end up in a situation of a split brain that's your cluster split into two clusters running side by side, then that's bad. But it's not going to happen like automatically.
Yeah, and Akka is pretty reasonable about handling the situation.
However,
however, if this happens and then you really want to have just one active partition and you don't want to down another one, then
Why can it happen? So, for example, you down you shrink your cluster, so you downsize it, and there are some dangling nodes that are unreachable anymore, but they are not going anytime soon. So you will normally need to remove them manually.
Or you simply have network problems.
Yeah,
which becomes clear. So different strategies with clever names, but they all, in essence, just about will I commit suicide? Or will I kill everyone else who is not reachable? So
So I'm going to go through those, and these are like automatic strategies that you can use to, if you don't want to manually go through your cluster and down those nodes that you know they are not going back anytime soon, then you can use an automatic algorithmic way of doing that for you. And there are this. I'm going to show you four different scenarios where this decision is taken in slightly different way. So, for example, the first one is static quorum, which means that you have a set number of nodes in your cluster, and then you specify that if you have a prolonged network split, then some of part of the cluster is going to decide to just kill themselves. And the part that is going to decide that is the one that is not big enough. So in that case, those four nodes, they realize that the four is less than six, so they are going to kill themselves, whereas the other nodes, the six is good enough, so they are going to survive.
That was our first choice when we started with clustering.
Yeah.
So but why wasn't it sufficient?
For two reasons. Like, first reason is that sometimes it may not save you for turning your cluster down, because if you have another split that is lasting for a long time, then all your cluster may suddenly decide to shut itself down, which is not ideal. And we also have this. Our cluster, it's not, it's a set of nodes, and we have always, when it's running properly, we have always the same number of nodes. But we change the size of the cluster quite dynamically when we redeploy new versions of those nodes, of those applications running side by side. So we decided to go for something like keep majority, where we don't define this. It's pretty similar to static quorum, but we don't define the static number. It's based on the last known size of the cluster. So in this scenario, again, the smaller size, like it knows that this cluster had 10 members and 4 is not big enough because it's less than half, so they are going to kill themselves. But the difference is that in the next scenario, the four nodes part is going to survive this thing. There are some two other strategies that you can use. They assume that one of your nodes is more important than the other. So, for example, it might be the oldest node, or you can specify explicitly that this is the referee node that you needs to survive the split all the time. And
what is special with this oldest node? Why is not the youngest node? It's fresh.
Yeah, so the oldest node is special in a way because it contains all singletons, for example. They are, by default, they are spawned on the oldest node, and all these also like. Actors that are related to how sharding works, they are also going to live on the oldest node, because by default this one is going to be the most stable. But the downside of that is if you have very uneven split in your cluster, then you are simply going to kill, or maybe I should say the majority of nodes are going to commit suicide at that point. And this you cannot do anything about this. It's just how it works, and that's not be something that you are after. So there is no one size fit all solution for utilizing all of those strategies.
Yeah, when we got a confirmation from NTT that we are going to have a talk, I thought that would be just technical talk. I usually do some songs about topic of my presentation, but since we have two speakers and we have a lot of content, I thought that this time it will be decent. But then I tweeted about it, and then Roger Johansson, who is one of major Akka.net contributors, he said that he requesting this year a song to be about different downing structures, about split resolvers. And this, since it was only the only request which we received about the content, we had to really satisfy it. So now 3 minutes of silliness, a song about split resolvers, brain split resolvers.
Okay, so I need not to screw up.
Yeah, we have some difficult logistic here.
Yep. Because okay.
This song, of course, exactly for this topic. When the cluster notes lose each other and the meaning is so unclear, 1001 log warnings become to dance in front of you, oh dear. Are they trying to tell you something? Your transactions not acid by base. Your events having same sequence number. Or you having two speakers on stage. My brain is slightly split. My brain is slightly split. It finally happened. It finally happened. Oh yeah. It finally happened. My brain is split. Oh dear. What I need is split brain resolver. It has strategies for my pain. I will only need one to treat me. And my brain will be whole again. Static quorum is for fixed number of nodes. Otherwise, keep majority is fine. Cluster singletons favor keep oldest. And the case for keep referee is not mine. My brain is slightly split. My brain is slightly split. It finally happened. Happened. It finally happened. Oh yeah. It finally happened. My brain is split. Just very slightly split. And there you have it. So that was obligatory 3 minutes of silence. Thank you.
Yeah, believe it or not, it's the first time I have heard this song. So world premiere.
I'm too shy to sing it to you. Yeah, so do we have time to wrap it up?
Yeah, I think we should go for that now.
Yeah, so now you see we're wrapping up and it's probably like Oslo will look in 50 years of global warming. So should we briefly talk about things like operations?
What did we take out of this joy of clusterizing our system?
Yeah, so it's not only developers who are actually affected.
Yeah, that's true. So if you are starting to run your service inside the cluster, then you need to communicate it to all other people that are involved in that. And in our case, it was mostly the operation people, because you can end up in a situation where seemingly you have services, like Windows services that are running, but everything got stuck in some unreachable state, and the cluster isn't performing any work. So we're experiencing that, and then you need to like teach them that they need to restart these services, that service in that case. So yeah, it requires some explanation to give to other people mm-hmm. inside your company.
So things start failing in different way.
Yeah.
Oh, sorry, we both. so then design. Actually, to implement cluster properly, it may require design like these persistent actors, which. Mentioned.
Yeah, so this is like the one that That was the most common one for us, that we needed to rethink where we actually store state in our system and move it to some more suitable places. But there are also some other things, like when we were working on clusterizing the system, we noticed that in some places we are sending functions inside a message to some actors, like we are passing actually functions. And this works as long as you are on a single actor system running on a single machine. But once you start running in this distributed environment, then you start to serialize those messages. And what do you do when you want to serialize your function? There is not really, it's not that easy.
Yeah.
So you need to also find all those different spots where you took shortcuts when you were designing your system.
But don't understand it in a way that cluster will require better design. This is the argument to have it in cluster. Actually, it might be opposite. With non-cluster system, you have more design options. So like you can be more relaxed about design. It's nothing wrong with that. It's just that with cluster, you will have to do some changes.
Yep.
And finally, high availability.
Yeah, so especially at the first time we deployed this our clustered application, what we noticed is that, if you do this properly, then you will actually win, do have these wins and those nice features that I was talking about related to high availability of a clustered applications. But if you screw up your configuration, for example, like or you have some bugs that you didn't squash before, then you may actually experience, and we experienced that at the very beginning of running a cluster, that there were some problems, and then it turned out that it was less stable than it used to be.
Yeah.
But yeah, this is something like a period that you need to go through because you are actually learning a lot of new things related to how do you maintain your cluster, how do you monitor its state, how do you determine the healthiness of each of the nodes. So once you gain this knowledge and once you realize how it works, then you can reach the state when it's actually the availability is higher and you can do cool stuff like restart your one of machines in production and nothing breaks in the whole application.
Yeah. So coming back to this picture of beautiful sunset, one thing for sure, as long as you're running your system, mission-critical system, in a single box, you can never be calmful and just enjoy a beautiful sunset. And going cluster way gives you such promise. So with that, we complete our presentation. Don't forget to vote. If you have questions, we are available here in the rest of the conference. And there is also a link to GitHub, I guess.
Yeah, there are some of the demos I showed. Yep.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Any question? Do we have time for questions?
Yeah, we have 8 minutes more. So if you have certain questions, then you can show.
Any questions? Yeah.
Well, so the thing is always to have run a single cluster. So thank you. So the question was, how do you handle the situations when you have split cluster and you have multiple clusters? And right, that's
RabbitMQ cluster, SQL cluster, and so on.
Exactly.
Of course, it depends on how this part of the system can communicate with the cluster. For example, take RabbitMQ. It's a cluster. And we have multiple subscribers. So actually, we cluster our system. And now we have multiple nodes. And they just, with Rabbit, it's implemented. They just will, it's like round robin. They will start fetching these messages. So if they are split, they will just continue doing it. RabbitMQ doesn't care. The same goes to your SQL database. But then hopefully you design your system in a way that if you access it from two multiple threads, it should be OK. If there is some affinity, like you need to have singleton, like it's only one thread that can access this database, because then you have to implement it as a singleton. And then it will be guarded by Akka tooling, that when you have this partitioning, as Pavel mentioned while we were going through this, that Akka will not create multiple singletons.
Does it answer your question? Okay, thank you.
More questions?
Are you happier now? Do you feel better?
Well, of course, we are happier now than we were 1 hour ago, because we did the talk. Okay, we will take it separately. Maybe you shouldn't be listening to answers. Me personally, I'm happy because, of course, running a system in a single box, it's something that you should not normally be doing on a system that requires high availability. And when it comes to TV radio programs, we usually send them on in advance. But when it comes to news clips, if we don't send them now, it's not news anymore, even if it's fake news. So we have to be really quick on that, and then we can't really afford just to run system single box. So we're talking about having system with a higher quality. For us, the most important thing is high availability. What do you think? Are you happier?
Yeah, I think I'm happier. I mean, at the beginning, we had some problems related to clustering, but then it was like, mostly some misconfigurations that I did, and then once it was fixed, then I think that we can say that we are happy with this shape of the system that we have.
Yeah, first few days, our operations were not happy, because like someone said, we didn't have clusters and things were like so bright. We have this service, you just have to look that this service is running. Now we have a cluster and like these nodes, they may.
And suddenly they have multiple different services. There is suddenly a bunch of them instead of single one. So it's like.
So there was a question in the eyes, do we really need this bloody cluster? Mm. Yeah, but I think now they also understand the importance. Yes, there are multiple strategies. One of them is round robin. Another one is
smallest mailbox,
which doesn't work well with so-called stashing. But yes, definitely you can balance it based on the load. Yeah.
Is it possible to use something in Akka so you can automate the system getting more healthy again? You can detect, this is real bad. We'll have to restart the Windows service or whatever.
That's a good question, actually. I mean, here's the thing. You have control.
The question was, are there any tools or means offered by Akka to diagnostic?
To self-diagnose the health of inside the cluster. So first thing is that the...
PBM?
Not really. I'm going to talk about this, detecting this unreachability. So the thing that you realize that something is not going okay with your cluster, because that's do you mean inside a cluster, like between nodes, or inside the single node that something is going wrong? Because that's like two different things.
The first one.
So the thing is that you have this unreachability event, so you can actually listen to them. And you can implement whatever way that you want to react on them. And you notice that this node starts seeing that all the other nodes are unreachable. Then you can subscribe to those events and then restart your service when this thing is detected. So this is one thing to automate that. The other thing to automate that is use one of those split brain strategies. I mean, they are going to detect this situation. They are going to shut down your actor system. But your actor system lives in some application, like Windows service, for example. So then you can react on this occurrence with restarting of your service, for example, if that makes sense. So yeah, this is how you can automate these things.
And I guess also it may depend on how many nodes you have. You have like hundreds of nodes, and you know, just keep shutting down things which look not
good. Yeah, but then you need to just add more of them later.
Yeah, if you have a very small number of nodes, you have to be more picky about what to do with them. I think we run out of official time, so we are still here for offline questions, and thanks again.
Thank you.